W.F. Howes presents an unabridged recording of, they call it diplomacy, 40 years of representing Britain abroad by Peter Westmacott, narrated by Jonathan Keeble. Forward. Diplomats often write memoirs, sometimes very well. When I left the British Diplomatic Service at the beginning of 2016, after 4 years as ambassador in Washington, I was asked on a number of occasions to write about my life and career. I had served longer than any other British diplomat in modern times, and was fortunate to have done so in fascinating and important countries at key moments in their and our history. But I hesitated. What, I asked myself, was the point? In the end, I decided that there was one, or perhaps three. First, to consider whether, in an age of instant communication, social media, special envoys and mass data, of which more had been created in the 2 years between 2015 and 2017 than in the entire history of mankind, the world still needed professional diplomats. Second, to try and explain what we did, apart from consume Ferrero Rocher chocolates, which we didn't. In early 2016, after my stint in Washington, I spent 3 months as a fellow at Harvard University's Kennedy School of Government. There I found the brilliant, hard-working and earnest students less interested in the foreign policy lessons I was dying to share with them than in answers to more practical questions like, what sort of person becomes a diplomat? How do you join the Foreign Service? What does successful diplomacy look like? Third, I wanted to tell a story showing what British diplomacy has been able to achieve, because my experience has been the exact opposite of the view of those Brexiteers who hold that being part of the European Union, EU, caused the UK to surrender its ability to conduct its own foreign policy, and that only with Brexit would we be able to rediscover a global role. Underlying it all was my sense that in a Brexit and Trumpian world, those of us who care about international relations and relationships were going to have to work harder to maintain a semblance of international order along with respect for truth and the rule of law. And, in the British case, to ensure that the UK remained a player commensurate with the relationships, knowledge and understanding we had acquired over the centuries of some of the world's most complex and challenging geostrategic problems. The trauma of the 2020 COVID-19 pandemic, in which there was far less international cooperation than there had been even 12 years earlier when we wrestled with the global financial crisis, only strengthened that view. Perhaps there is a fourth reason. After almost 44 years doing my best to defend party lines, I am free, within reason, to say what I think. Chapter 1. Beginnings. I joined the Foreign and Commonwealth Office, FCO, as it was still known when I wrote these words, in 1972 at the age of 21, fresh out of university. I had little idea what it was, and even less of what the rest of the world looked like. We hadn't travelled as a family when I was young. Times were hard in 1950s Britain, and food stamps and petrol rationing were part of life in the small village of Eddington in Somerset where I was born, in my parents' downstairs bedroom, and spent the first 10 years of my life. There was no television, no car, and no refrigerator in those early years. At the age of 40, my father, not that unusually for people of his generation who had been in the thick of war and come through it physically, at least unscathed, gave up a promising career in the Royal Navy, went to theological college and became a clergyman in the Diocese of Bath and Wells in southwest England. He spent 3 years as a curate in Weston-super-Mare, and then a further 20 as vicar of Long Ashton, outside Bristol. He set aside his early retirement lump sum to pay for my two older brothers and me to go to Taunton School. It helped the finances when, to his disbelief, I won a scholarship covering half the fees. I was immediately streamed into the arts rather than science side of the school, and left 4 years later without having taken a single lesson in physics, biology, chemistry, or zoology. Those of us studying art subjects had to do an obligatory one afternoon a week general science course. When I once asked our long-suffering teacher if we could do something useful, like learn about the internal combustion engine, rather than fool around with a Bunsen burner, so that we would know how to fix the kind of second- or third-hand car many of us aspired to own once we had passed our driving test, I was told that practical science wasn't part of the syllabus. I wasn't a big reader and struggled with history lessons, which I recall as mainly memorable for having my sideburns tugged sharply and painfully upwards by the teacher whenever he didn't get the answer he wanted. Perhaps not surprisingly, I found myself concentrating on languages which I enjoyed and wondering what other cultures and countries were really like. At the age of 15, I left Britain for the first time and took myself off for 3 weeks to Northeim, a small town in Lower Saxony, part of what was then West Germany, to stay with the family, learn some German and begin finding out. I went by ferry and train, feeling pleased with the progress I had made until I discovered that in Hanover I had got on the express train to Munich rather than the stopping train that visited all stations on the same route. A kindly guard took pity on the terrified English schoolboy with halting German and told me to get off at the next big town and take the local train back up the line. There were no mobile phones in those days, of course, so I worried that the family who had come to meet me might give up when I was not on the right train. Fortunately, the local train arrived before the one I should have taken from Hanover, and all was well. In Northeim, I sometimes went to the local high school, or gymnasium, with my host, a very kind schoolboy of my age, and helped with English conversation classes. On other days, I went travelling with his father, a salesman for industrial bakery equipment, who tried, to his son's distress, to tell me that Hitler had done the world a service by gassing millions of Jews. At least the experience was good for my German. I remember in particular being taken to visit the beautiful medieval university town of Göttingen, which wasn't far away, and the nearby heavily guarded border with East Germany, with its menacing watchtowers every few hundred yards along the frontier that then separated free, democratic West Germany from the communist East. In my last year at school, like other leavers, I signed up for career weekends arranged by potential employers. I joined one generously arranged at Fannums Hall, a grand house near Ware in Hertfordshire, by what was then Westminster Bank. At the end, when asked to write an assessment of the weekend, I did so, but also cheekily asked whether the bank would like to find me a job in France for the 9 months I would have spare between school and university. I was staying on for an extra term after taking my A-levels to sit the Oxford University entrance exam, and liked the idea of speaking some French and earning a little money. To my surprise, they agreed, and sent me a return air ticket to Lyon. I had flown before, once, in a small biplane linking Cornwall to the Isles of Scilly, but I still remember gazing out of the window of the Boeing 707 at the amazing cloud formations we flew over. Heaven knows why British Airways put such a large plane on such a short route, but it added to my sense of wonder. I spent the first half of 1969 working at the Westminster Foreign Bank in Lyon, and witnessing the end of Charles de Gaulle's political career when he resigned in April after losing a referendum he never needed to hold. Dangerous things, referenda, as my French political friends reminded us to no avail half a century later. For several months I traded English conversation classes for a bedroom in the flat of Bruno Charmaton and his family in Caluire on the outskirts of Lyon. The weekends we spent restoring a cottage they had bought on the edge of Beaujolais country. It helped enormously with my construction vocabulary, my do-it-yourself or bricolage skills, and my appreciation of the wines of Morgon, Gicondas, and Fleury. But I fear Bruno's English didn't advance as rapidly. Having passed the entrance exam and squeaked through what I still remember as an embarrassingly bad interview, I took up my place at New College, Oxford, in October 1969. There was no family connection. But that didn't stop Iris, the very welcoming wife of the warden, Sir William Hayter, remarking, as she showed the new boys round on day one, that she supposed I was there because of the stone carvings on the reredos of the college chapel, executed by the 19th-century sculptor and my ancestor, Sir Richard Westmacott. I had no idea that he had been given that commission, But for the rest of my time at the college, when I often went to the short evensongs sung each day by the wonderful new college choir, I looked on the back wall of the chapel behind the altar with special affection. I had been admitted to read French and German. Once there, I decided that old French texts, middle-high German, and linguistics were not for me. So I dropped the German and opted for a degree course combining modern history with a European language. I chose French, and hoped my poor performance as a history student at school wouldn't drag me down too far. My tutors warned that this new hybrid degree course, neither one thing nor the other, would end any aspiration I might have of pursuing an academic career. I had none, and felt I had come up with the perfect combination. For my history special subject, I chose the French Revolution, and for French, I chose the social history depicted in the novels of the 19th century French author Honoré de Balzac. I spent three fascinating and rewarding years at New College, and have believed ever since that those lucky enough to learn in an inspiring physical environment, 600 years old in the case of New College, or brand new in the case of some iconic modern schools, have a head start in life. Two summers in a row, I joined a party of students and fellows for a fortnight of reading and walking at an old wooden chalet on the lower slopes of Mont Blanc, which University College, Balliol, and New College had co-owned for the previous 75 years. The chalet had no electricity or running water, but it had a special atmosphere, and rarely did anyone return home the worse for the experience or the survival cooking. We took it in turns to walk down the mountain to buy food and to prepare the meals. At Oxford, I formed some lasting friendships, but was too timid to tackle the, to me, frightening institution of the Oxford Union and high-profile societies and clubs frequented by those with more money and better connections than me. I found myself elected president of my junior common room, less because of any political activism on my part than because the candidates on the left and right were too polarizing for most of my fellow students. In my last year, unsure how best to go about earning a living, I sought the advice of people I respected and whose judgment I trusted. My old Taunton School headmaster, John Ray, by then in charge of Westminster School, thought I should try the Foreign Office. People still hadn't got used to the addition in 1968 of the word Commonwealth to its title, which changed again to Foreign, Commonwealth and Development Office in 2020. So did Warden Hayter, himself a former diplomat. Back then, when there were far fewer graduates coming onto the job market than there are today, those of us leaving university were almost spoiled for choice. I knew nothing of diplomacy, though my grandfather had served in military intelligence in Brussels in the 1920s, pretending to be an entry clearance officer at the embassy after serious injuries sustained at Ypres during the First World War had invalided him out of the army. Like so many others, my family had lost lives, limbs, property, and much else during the two world wars and the Great Depression of the 1920s. So I gave it a go. The application process began with a written civil service selection board examination, common to all university graduates seeking to join the civil service. Passing that exam took you through to a second round, comprising 2 days of written tests and interviews, one of which I remember involving a lot of questions about my relationship with my father, which made little sense until I realized afterwards that my interviewer had been a psychoanalyst. Then there was a third and final round, at which the FCO fielded its own panel of interviewers with a set of questions quite distinct from those put to candidates looking to join the home civil service. Somehow, the examiners whittled the thousands of applicants down to 20, and eventually, after what seemed like a very long wait, I heard I had been accepted. I hesitated between taking up the offer I had received from the FCO and joining an investment bank or an insurance company. Wrongly, I felt that the FCO would only give me one chance, and that if I chose to go into finance, didn't like it, and wanted to switch to diplomacy later, I would not be allowed to do so. I thought the private sector would be far more accommodating if, after a few years of diplomacy, I decided to change horses. In fact, the FCO has always welcomed applicants with experience of other professions, but I didn't know that at the time. William Hayter warned me that in his day, the Foreign Office didn't pay salaries. He had heard that they did now. If I didn't have private means, he intoned, I might want to check that that was the case. I certainly did, since I had nothing in the bank. The answer, fortunately, was yes. The starting salary would be £1,530 a year, less than N.M. Rothschild and Sons were offering, but not deal-breakingly so. I took the plunge. 40 years later, when, as ambassador in Paris, I went to look him up, my old Lyonnaise friend, Bruno Charmaton, claimed credit for my decision. He recalled driving me through the winding roads of the Haute-Loire one weekend in the summer of 1971, and me asking him what I should do with my life. Bruno had replied, he said, that I was useless, nul, at business. My performance as a summer intern at Black & Decker, where he was commercial director, clearly hadn't impressed him, so I should try diplomacy instead. I have no recollection of this conversation, but perhaps part of me was already leaning that way. Telling the story clearly gave Bruno enormous pleasure, so I didn't contest it. At the end of August 1972, I found myself one of 20 new entrants joining the FCO, helping each other find our way round the intimidating corridors of the FCO's main building, Gilbert Scott's 19th-century Italianate statement of architectural grandeur in King Charles Street, London, SW1. Small events of no apparent consequence sometimes stick in the memory for a lifetime. I remember during my first weeks in the FCO a chance encounter in the corridor with Tony Parsons, the chairman of the final selection board that had admitted me to the FCO 7 months earlier, and hearing this very senior undersecretary greet me with a cheery, "Hello, Peter. I'm glad you got in." This grandee had remembered my face and name, and cared enough to make the new boy feel wanted. After a short induction course, each new entrant was assigned to one of the FCO's 36 geographical or functional departments. Chance determined that mine was to be Middle East Department, MED, where I would learn on the job as assistant desk officer for South Yemen and Oman. The array of talent and plain niceness I encountered amazed me. All my colleagues had already been on postings abroad, and almost all would end up as senior heads of mission. Some of my fellow recruits joined convinced they would end up as a top ambassador, or as the permanent undersecretary, PUS, the most senior civil servant in the office. But I doubt if I was alone in wondering whether I would ever be able to match the ability and self-confidence of my new colleagues, who, incidentally, could not have made me feel more welcome. Before I had even crossed the threshold, I had a phone call from my future head of department, Patrick Wright, who himself went on to become PUS. I had cheekily asked for 5 days' leave, including a weekend, to get married less than a month after I was due to join his team. Patrick was calling to say this was absurd. My heart sank. He had, he continued, been denied any time off when he had married his wife Virginia, so I should get my marriage off to a decent start and take a fortnight. I put the phone down, amazed that my new boss should have taken the trouble to find my parents' number and call me up to deliver such a kind and understanding message. The collegiality of the departments into which the FCO was organised and the sense of belonging it gave to the 20 or 30 people in each one was hugely reassuring to new recruits. It also engendered pride, teamwork and loyalty. When in later years departments were broken up into teams and directorates, and there was no longer a culture of everyone bringing their mug to the head of department's PA's office for a few minutes at tea time, something precious was lost. Those few minutes were time well spent, especially if they meant there was less need later for hours of painful counselling of lost, struggling souls. In early 1973, not long after I joined, our intake went off for 5 days to Wilton Park, a fine country house on the South Downs in Sussex, which now serves as the FCO's in-house conference centre. With us were a handful of new recruits from the 6 original member states of the European Economic Community, EEC, as it then was. The UK had joined on the 1st of January that year, and the idea was to get young British diplomats used to the idea of EEC membership and in the process build relationships with opposite numbers in other European capitals, of whom they would be seeing plenty in the years to come. It was a brilliant idea, and we all found the time we spent together enjoyable and useful. Unfortunately, the exercise wasn't repeated in future years. One of my modest achievements years later, when William Hague was Foreign Secretary, was to persuade him to reintroduce the same programme of joint training with young diplomats from other EU countries. In several other respects, I was fortunate in starting out in Med. We had a special relationship with Oman, since, not for the first time in that part of the world, Britain had been instrumental in putting the young Sultan Qaboos on his throne 2 years earlier. His father had deliberately kept the Sultanate in medieval conditions, which did not bode well for a peaceful succession. Qaboos had learned English in Britain, renting a modest room in the suburbs of London from a landlady whom he subsequently invited to Muscat for a month every year until she died. He went on to the Royal Military Academy at Sandhurst, where he acquired a network of military relationships which stood him and the servicemen who became his friends in good stead for the rest of their lives. Those links and the Sultan's respect for the British Special Forces were further strengthened by the role the British Army played in helping him win the war against communist-backed rebels in Dhofar province in the southwest of his kingdom, a war which was still being fought when I joined Med in September 1972. As late as 2018, the Sultan, despite already suffering from a terminal illness, was still inviting a small group of retired British grandees from the worlds of defence, intelligence, and finance to join him for an off-the-record dinner once a year. It was a much more intimate relationship than we had managed to maintain with the other Gulf states which we governed until Britain withdrew militarily from east of Suez in 1971, partly because successive British governments have given those countries the impression that they only merit high-level attention when we need something from them, like a large arms contract. When the Sultan died in January 2020, I was privately glad that the Prince of Wales, the Prime Minister, and several other senior figures went to Muscat to offer condolences. No other government came close to showing such appreciation for the late Sultan and his country. We had history too in next-door South Yemen, the other country in my patch. Back then, there were two Yemens. One was the People's Democratic Republic, which was neither the People's nor democratic, but had emerged from the bitter civil war between rival factions, set off by Britain's announcement in 1966 that it was leaving the Aden Protectorate 2 years later. We in fact left in 1967, shades of the haste with which Lord Mountbatten had brought forward the partition of India 20 years earlier. The other Yemen was the Yemen Arab Republic to the north, which was closely allied to Saudi Arabia. Governance development and the payment of pensions to former government servants of the Aden Protectorate were all part of what I found on my desk when I showed up for work in my new role. Chapter 2. 4 years in Iran, 1973 to 1978. Those formative months in Med gave me an early understanding of the baggage Britain had left behind in the region, but also a taste for the Middle East, which soon led to my decision to learn Persian. The FCO was, and still is, renowned for the systematic way it trains its young diplomats in foreign languages. We were all expected to have adequate French, and to be able to learn enough Spanish, German, or Italian to get by, if we had to. But those who did respectably in the office's language aptitude test and had the inclination were given up to 2 years, depending on the difficulty of the language, to learn Mandarin, Japanese, Korean, Arabic, Russian, or any other hard language necessary to communicate and understand what was going on in countries of importance to the UK. Then, as now, whenever possible, we appointed as ambassadors diplomats who were both up to the job and had learned the language and the culture of the country earlier in their careers. In my case, I saw enough of the Arab world and of my Arabist colleagues in my first months as a diplomat to realise that, fascinating as the geopolitics were, learning Arabic risked limiting me to a career which would rarely take me out of the region. So, instead of going for a language spoken in 17 different countries, in Persian I chose one which was not only the key to understanding a people, civilization, and country with thousands of years of history, but was also only spoken in two countries, Iran and Afghanistan. In the latter, the main official language, Dari, is in effect the same as Persian. Persian, or Farsi, as it is known in Iran, is not as difficult as Arabic or the East Asian languages, although reading, writing, and getting to grips with the structures of some Persian words requires a rudimentary knowledge of Arabic. As an Indo-European language, Farsi is much closer to our European Romance languages than, say, Turkish, which fools you into thinking it is going to be easier because Mustafa Kemal Ataturk, the founder of the Turkish Republic, decreed in the 1920s that the Ottoman script should be replaced by Latin letters and numbers. In fact, Turkish has more in common with Korean and, oddly, Finnish than any European language. But learning Farsi was no walk in the park. I was sent off to London University's School of Oriental and African Studies, SOAS, for 2 terms. There, along with a small number of other diplomats, soldiers, and would-be academics, I was taught by the formidable Professor Anne Nancy Lampton, who had written numerous books about Iran, crossed the country on horseback disguised as a man, served in the British Embassy in Tehran during the Second World War, and incurred the displeasure of the Shah for being critical of his land reform program. In the classroom, she was reputed to have reduced hardened special forces officers to tears. Back in 1964, she had written a seminal study of the Iranian branch of Shia Islam, known as Twelver Shiism, because of its attachment to the 12th, or hidden, imam, who disappeared in the 9th century and is expected by Shia Muslims to return one day and fill the world with justice and peace. Her book also explained the importance the Shia attach to creating the kingdom of God on earth, and the risk this carries of bringing about violent revolution. Perhaps she was mellowing by the time she took me on, and it may have helped that we played squash together. She usually won. 35 years later, shortly after Nancy died at the age of 96, another of her former students, David Morgan, sent me the text of a talk he had given about her to the Royal Asiatic Society. It contained this passage. The language student she rated the best she had ever taught was a diplomat at the beginning of his career who took the course 3 years after I did. So far as I know, he is unaware that he holds this distinction. He is currently the British ambassador in Paris. Having sat trembling in her classroom for 2 terms, feeling as inadequate as my classmates, I simply couldn't believe it. One of the strengths of our system was the scope it gave young officers to build on what they learned in the classroom with a few months of immersion in the local culture. But even in the relatively liberal 1970s, it wasn't easy to find Iranian families who were able to take in as paying guests unaccompanied non-Muslim foreigners who wanted to be treated as part of the family. I was lucky enough to find a Christian family who lived modestly in the southern city of Shiraz and were prepared to rent me a room and help with conversation classes. More formal tuition was provided at the British Council, which was then occupying the magnificent premises and garden of the former Consulate General, built in the 19th century by the engineers of the Indian Army, and which the FCO had given up some years earlier. Valuable as the lessons were, I was only too glad to supplement them with hours whiled away in the Shiraz Bazaar, learning about tribal rugs, visiting the breathtaking remains of the Achaemenid, Parthian, and Sasanian civilizations, which had left their traces across the province of Fars over the previous 2,500 years, and visiting the local Kashkai tribes in their tented villages. More than 40 years after leaving Iran, I still have a weakness for the natural dyes and designs, no two ever the same, of fine old Kashkai rugs, hand-knotted by women living the kind of migratory tribal life now largely consigned to Iran's anthropological history. I visited Isfahan, halfway between Tehran and Shiraz, whenever I had the opportunity, since it has the greatest collection of mosques and other Islamic treasures of any city in Iran. Looking at the gold and turquoise tiled domes of Isfahan's Friday Mosque, the Masjid-i-Shah, or any of the other great monuments of the Safavid era, I found myself wondering what it was about Shia Islam that led its architects to emphasize the external beauty of their buildings and to make the areas of prayer open to the heavens, while those of the Sunni Ottoman Empire, most notably Sinan, chose to focus the minds and the gaze of the faithful on the interiors of the Suleymaniye, Sultanahmet, Blue, and other great mosques of Istanbul. Istanbul's magnificent Hagia Sophia fell into neither category. Originally built as a Byzantine cathedral by Emperor Justinian in the 6th century, and for centuries the largest unsupported dome in the world, it only became a mosque after the fall of Constantinople in 1453. Ataturk made it into a museum in 1935 as a symbol of the new Turkish Republic's Western and secular orientation, a decision which President Recep Tayyip Erdogan reversed in 2020 when Hagia Sophia, as it is called in Turkish, once again became a mosque, to some local excitement, but to the distress of Christian leaders around the world. Isfahan was and is a city to which I also have a sentimental attachment. Thanks to Sir Dennis Wright, a distinguished former British ambassador to Iran, who was about to publish The English Amongst the Persians, I learned shortly before leaving the UK that one of my antecedents on my mother's side was a Persian-speaking surgeon called Andrew Jukes, who served as a doctor, translator, and diplomatic representative of the East India Company in the Bushire Residency on the Persian Gulf Coast in the early 19th century. Jukes was on a mission to introduce smallpox vaccinations to rural Persia when he died of cholera in Isfahan in 1821. He remains the only foreigner with a tombstone in the graveyard of what was then known as All Saviours Armenian Cathedral in the Isfahan suburb of Julfa, where it remains intact today. Jukes was also, I was sorry to discover, one of many foreign travellers to carve his name, quite elegantly, into the marble of the Gate of All Nations at Persepolis, Iran's most important and impressive archaeological site, when he visited in 1804. Those months in Shiraz provided me with opportunities to meet people who could help me understand the local culture. One particular friend was Dr. Hushang Ordubadi, a psychotherapist who taught at the local Pahlavi University. I was sometimes unnerved by the way he seemed to look through me and observe exactly what I was thinking or feeling. But I kept with me for many years his comment that Iranians would always follow a bold leader who knew where he was going as long as he remained a few steps ahead of events. The Shah, Mohammad Reza Pahlavi, lost his throne in 1979 when events left him behind. Staff movements in Tehran meant that my language immersion was cut short, and I ended up with 9 rather than the scheduled 12 months of Farsi training. But there was a silver lining. Arriving in Tehran to take up my first overseas posting as third secretary in the embassy's chancery in June 1974, the new ambassador turned out to be none other than my old mentor, Tony Parsons. He called me in on my first day to give me a job, take his Rolls Royce and 2 silk carpets he had been given by a wealthy industrialist, Rahim Evani, of the Kafsh Emeli Shoe Company, and return to the embassy with the Rolls Royce, but without the carpets, or any damage to his personal relations with the donor. I returned a couple of hours later, having achieved the first part of my mission, but not the second. However, I had learned an important lesson. In the Middle East, to return a gift is to cause grave offence, and since admiring someone else's possession automatically means it is offered to you as a gift, it is best to keep your admiration to yourself. It was rare then, and it is rare now, to find people with such an exceptional mix of analytical brilliance, humility, integrity, and what we now call interpersonal skills, as Sir Anthony Parsons. But he was operating with one disadvantage. He was an Arabist, not a Persian expert, which led him and others to be very harsh on his performance when the British government failed to foresee that the Shah's regime would come crashing down at the end of 1978. As the young Persian-speaking political officer in the embassy, my role was to travel the country, talk to people, understand what was going on, explain it to my colleagues and to London, and do what I could to make people feel positively about my country. Linguistic difficulties aside, Iran was a tough nut to crack. Although for hundreds of years there had been close relations between Britain and the Safavid and subsequently Qajar empires, Iranians knew that the UK had agreed with Russia at the beginning of the 20th century to divide their country into zones of influence, and been responsible for helping put the Cossack Colonel Reza Shah on the throne in 1925. In 1941, when Britain felt he had become dangerously pro-German, we exiled him to South Africa and arranged for his son, Mohammad Reza, to take his place. Iranians also knew that, with the Americans, we had made a significant contribution to the fall of Mohammad Mossadegh, their elected prime minister in 1953. Footnote: in August 1953, the US and UK governments conspired to overthrow the government of Mohammad Mossadegh, with whom the Anglo-Iranian Oil Company, later BP, was in dispute over oil prices and production. The two governments had also become convinced that he had communist tendencies. After a false start, the coup succeeded in having Mossadegh arrested, while the Shah, Mohammad Reza Pahlavi, was confirmed in power. At a critical moment, the streets of Tehran were taken over by mobs, paid in cash by the CIA team on the spot, led by the legendary Kim Roosevelt. By the late 1970s, when Ayatollah Ruhollah Khomeini was threatening the survival of the Iranian monarchy, one of the jokes in Tehran was that if you lifted Khomeini's beard, you would see Sacte Inglis, made in England, written underneath. The Shah didn't like the intelligence agencies of his allies frequenting mosques or talking to opposition groups. He believed they were there to help him combat the threat from communist groups. The Russians, after all, had set up a short-lived communist regime in Iran's northwest province of Azerbaijan at the end of the Second World War. So it was left to a small number of what were once called Oriental secretaries, people like me, in Western embassies, to try and work out what was happening. I took myself off to as many of the provinces as I could make the time to visit, often alone and driving myself. Even in the most remote parts of the country, the roads were good. Local mayors, governors, and heads of universities were welcoming and informative. Children went to modern schools in smart uniforms. People watched what they said to this inquisitive foreigner. The ubiquitous and much feared intelligence organization SAVAK was never far away. But they never tried to interfere with my travels. And only at the beginning of 1978 did I begin to feel I might be travelling through a pre-revolutionary land. 40 years later, when I was ambassador in Washington, and the US still had no diplomatic representation in Tehran following the break in relations at the time of the 1979 revolution, I noticed how the US administration appreciated regular contact with British diplomats visiting from Tehran. Sharing the knowledge acquired by our own people on the ground in a country of such complexity and importance to US interests was a valuable contribution we were able to make to our side of Churchill's special relationship. In the mid-1970s, Iran was where everyone wanted to be. Western economies were in the doldrums, suffering from high inflation, interest rates, and unemployment. Iran was newly rich, following the Shah's decision to triple the price of oil on New Year's Eve 1973, and he was keen to drive forward a program of modernization in partnership with Iran's Western allies. Investment bankers, oil company executives, con men, fixers, arms salesmen, military training teams, civil engineers, educational specialists, everyone showed up. There was also a huge influx of high-level visitors, including from the royal family, always appreciated by the Shah and his relatives. My role included putting together programs and accompanying visitors on their out-of-town trips when a Persian speaker could come in handy. Taking my parents with me when I had to accompany the Queen Mother on an official visit to Isfahan, staying at the magnificent Shah Abbas Hotel was a highlight. Their contact with members of the royal family had been limited to social events at the officers' mess in Malta when my father was stationed there in the early 1950s, at the same time as Prince Philip, later the Duke of Edinburgh, whose wife, the then Princess Elizabeth, would visit whenever she could. I left Iran in March 1978, less than a year before the revolution, which was completed with Ayatollah Khomeini's triumphant return from France in February 1979, courtesy of an Air France Boeing 747. The British government was so scarred by its failure to foresee the collapse of the Shah's peacock throne that the FCO took the unusual step of asking a former member of the Tehran embassy, Nick Brown, to carry out a post-mortem. In the days before email, we didn't automatically copy all our internal reports to London, and most of the files kept in the embassy had to be destroyed when the revolution happened. This meant Nick had access only to documents available in London and to people serving in the embassy at the time. Almost the only document he turned up foreseeing trouble was a paper I wrote in early 1978, following a visit I made to Tabriz after at least a dozen students were killed when the military put down a student protest in the local university. That, and a demonstration in the holy city of Qum a month earlier, had been sparked by the most unwise decision of someone in the Shah's inner circle to place an article in Etelat newspaper on the 7th of January, blaming Ayatollah Khomeini, exiled in Iraq, for all the unrest. My note was not particularly bold or prescient, but it did say that, while I did not wish to sound alarmist, there were a number of distinct things, which I listed, going wrong, which, should they begin to coalesce, might bring the stability of the Shah's regime into question. Nick highlighted the cautious tone of my conclusion as a symptom of the culture of an embassy that was reluctant to address unwelcome realities, but noted that at least someone had begun to hint at the possibility of trouble ahead. I had adopted that cautious tone because I was still young and inexperienced, and was basing my tentative judgment more on a hunch than on evidence. But Nick was right that the mission as a whole wasn't sure what was going on. We were also conscious that the Shah would not look kindly on countries which regarded themselves as his close allies, showing signs of beginning to lose confidence, or of hedging their bets, and we needed his business. With dissidents fearful of the brutal reach of SAVAK, I found myself resorting to sending messages on scraps of paper by courier to fix meetings with people I wanted to talk to. A lawyer friend came to lunch one day towards the end of 1977 with his arm in plaster. It had, he said, been broken by SAVAK. There were some potentially destabilizing things going wrong. Bazaar merchants losing their monopolies to import sugar and other essentials. Lawyers concerned about the lack of rule of law, rebellious students, fringe political parties, communist as well as Islamist, hitherto cowed clerics empowered by the decision of the authorities to blame the unrest on Khomeini. A public opinion encouraged by some of the Shah's own limited reforms to believe that they could ask for more. At times, egregious corruption on the part of the Shah's family and their cronies. And finally, a concern that we had all been feeling for some years about the Shah's increasing isolation and lack of an inner circle he would listen to, as its members either died or fell out of favour. As the spring of 1978 turned to summer, the political temperature heated up. On the 19th of August, there was a particularly tragic event in Abadan, in the southwest, which, with hindsight, may have made the revolution inevitable. On the 25th anniversary of the 1953 coup against Prime Minister Mohammad Mossadegh, at least 400 people died when attackers barred the doors to the cinema Rex, doused the building in petrol and set fire to it. The government blamed radical Islamists. Revolutionaries blamed SAVAK. Public opinion was outraged. Today, it is generally believed that a pro-Khomeini group was responsible. In September, 6 months after leaving Tehran, I ran into Tony Parsons outside the FCO in Whitehall. He was on mid-tour leave, the one time during their four-year overseas tours when diplomats were allowed a substantial, fair-paid break back in the UK. These days, staff get an annual return airfare and are encouraged not to be away for such long periods. Knowing he had already been back for a good 3 months, and that the politics in Tehran were deteriorating, I asked Tony why he was still in London. He said people had given it careful thought, but London felt that for him to return early from his leave might suggest we had lost confidence in the Shah. When he did return, after almost 4 months away, he went straight to see the Shah. He reported by cable that night that Iran's leader had lost the will to fight, and it looked as though the game was over. The absence of the embassy's key man at the key time meant that the British government had failed to realise until very late in the day that we were losing a vital ally in the Middle East. It was typical of the man that in his memoir, The Pride and the Fall, Parsons criticised himself for not having seen the revolution coming. Perhaps if he had been an Iran specialist as well as, or instead of, being an Arabist, and if he had been there throughout the difficult summer of 1978, he would have sensed the danger. But almost none of the so-called experts did. And if Parsons was to blame, so were those running the embassy in his absence, and perhaps those of us on his team who had failed to join the dots earlier. On the other hand, revolutions tend to happen precisely because people don't see them coming. And in the case of Iran, there weren't many dots to join. The warning signs I had tentatively flagged were far from definitive, and I for one felt until quite late in 1978 that a determined stand by the Shah, the military and his senior ministers, possibly including the distribution of small sums of money of the kind that had made such a difference on the streets of Tehran back in 1953, might have reversed the momentum of discontent. Today, in the light of what we now know of the ability of radical imams to mobilise support in the bazaar and the mosque, that feels unrealistic. But at the time, the situation was not as clear-cut as some historians now claim. Among Western governments, the French probably came closest to calling it right, and seeing that the Shah's days were numbered, perhaps because they had access to medical reports prepared by the Shah's French doctors on his lymphoma, and the effects treatment was having on his behaviour. But all Iran's partners and allies had an interest in believing, or at least hoping for, the best, given the state of the global economy and the acute need of many Western economies to take advantage of Iran's newfound oil wealth. 1978-79 was, after all, the winter of discontent in Britain, marked by the widespread strikes and economic weaknesses which cost Prime Minister James Callaghan his job in the general election of May 1979. Iranians, especially those who consider the revolution a national disaster, criticise US President Jimmy Carter's administration for having given conflicting messages to the Shah at critical moments at the end of 1978 and beginning of 1979, and for himself being equivocal in his public remarks. There was also criticism of Western governments for not wanting to risk causing offence to the Shah by telling him where he was going wrong before it was too late. In his own way, Mohammad Reza Pahlavi did try and take some cautious steps towards political reform, for example by allowing the establishment of legitimate political parties, such as the government-sponsored Rastakhiz, or Resurgence Party. But as in France in 1789 and Russia in 1917, it was too little to buy off opponents who were only encouraged by the beginnings of a reform process and growing evidence that the object of their discontent wasn't prepared to commit mass murder to stay in power. As the French historian Alexis de Tocqueville explained in L'Ancien Régime et la Révolution, The Old Regime and the Revolution back in 1856, the most dangerous moment for autocrats is when they begin to reform, and when the plight of their subjects is beginning to improve. It's a lesson that has not been lost on the leaders of China, Islamic Iran, and other repressive states in more recent times. As in France in 1789, Russia in 1917, and Egypt in 2011, so in Tehran in 1979 it was often brave, liberal activists who set the process in motion and took the greatest risks, who became the first victims of the forces they had unleashed, but found they could not control. Would more genuine reform have allowed Iran to evolve into something akin to a constitutional monarchy? Possibly, if the Shah had avoided other errors, curbed the excesses of his relatives and still had people around him who were able and willing to dispense unwelcome but necessary advice. But the evidence from elsewhere in the region suggests that it was the autocrats who brooked no dissent, like Saddam Hussein in Iraq, Hafez and then Bashar al-Assad in Syria, Muammar Gaddafi in Libya, and Hosni Mubarak in Egypt, until the Americans disowned him, who survived best. For the Shah, there was never the option of the Faustian Pact the ruling al-Saud family struck with the religiously conservative Sunni ulema of their kingdom that allowed them free rein and plenty of money to export their fundamentalist form of Wahhabism to other Sunni countries in exchange for making no trouble at home. Footnote. Wahhabism is a conservative Islamic doctrine founded by Muhammad bin Abd al-Wahhab in the 18th century in the Najd region of what is now Saudi Arabia. It is largely interchangeable with Salafism. After al-Wahhab made a pact with Muhammad bin Saud, founder of the dynasty which rules Saudi Arabia today, Wahhabism became the dominant strand of religious thinking in the region, and subsequently Saudi Arabia's official form of Islam. I'm not sure even the Shah realized the threat posed by Khomeini. The French were criticized at the time for granting Khomeini safe haven shortly before the end of 1978. But the first they knew of the Ayatollah's decision to leave the holy city of Najaf in Iraq, where he'd been living in exile since the 1960s, was when the duty officer at the Elysee Palace took a call from Orly Airport on the 8th of October, saying there was an old man with a long beard and a white robe seeking to enter France on a tourist visa, and saying he was Ayatollah Khomeini. President Valéry Giscard d'Estaing decided the Shah should be asked if he wanted him sent back to Iraq. No, the Shah replied, because he thought Khomeini would be a greater threat if he was returned to Najaf and Saddam Hussein against his will. That may have been a misjudgment. Saddam Hussein and the Shah had buried the hatchet in Algiers in 1975, in a deal which ended the boundary dispute over the Shatt al-Arab waterway between their two countries, and, not for the first or last time in their tragic history, left the Iraqi Kurds high and dry. Saddam had little time for Shia theologians, so he was unlikely to have allowed Khomeini to continue to make trouble at the Shah's expense from Iraqi territory, and unlikely, unless the Shah was complicit, to confer on him the martyrdom which could have unleashed a really violent revolution in next-door Iran. Moreover, at that time, Khomeini was still considered an outsider, even for the Islamic groups looking for a Shia-led revolution against the Shah's government. There were few takers then for Khomeini's idea of bringing forward the perfect Islamic state, which, under Shia theology, could only come into existence with the return of the 12th Imam, or Mahdi, who had disappeared in the 9th century. Few saw the risk that Khomeini meant what he had been preaching about Velayat al-Faqih, a concept which turned on its head traditional Shia theology that governance should be the responsibility of a secular state until the return of the Mahdi. Footnote. The concept first surfaced in a book co-authored by Khomeini in 1970. Pending the return of the 12th Imam, it transfers all political and religious authority to the Shia clergy and makes all major decisions affecting the state subject to a supreme clerical jurist, or faqih, a role which Khomeini assumed for himself after Iran's 1979 revolution. Instead, the revolutionaries saw the opportunistic benefits of harnessing a firebrand whose sermons were beginning to be distributed throughout the bazaars of Iran's big cities on cassette tapes. Thanks to plenty of exposure through the international media, not least the BBC's World Service, which his flight to France had given him, just 3 months later, Khomeini had forced the Shah to flee his country. Khomeini returned himself to Tehran in triumph, on the 1st of February 1979. It is often forgotten now, given the attention that has been paid in recent years to the military potential of Iran's nuclear program, that in the mid-1970s, the West and the Soviet Union had such confidence in the Shah's peaceful intentions that we were falling over ourselves to help him develop a nuclear-powered electricity industry. During my time in Tehran, the Germans, and subsequently the Soviets, after Kraftwerk Union got fed up with not being paid on time, were involved in constructing Iran's first nuclear power stations on the shores of the Persian Gulf at Bushehr. The French sold the Shah a share in Eurodif, their uranium enrichment company. The Russians offered nuclear fuel, while we in Britain, no longer capable of offering nuclear reactors for export, proposed an ambitious training package led by Sir Walter Marshall, the charismatic director of the Atomic Energy Research Establishment at Harwell in Oxfordshire. Marshall was a blunt, overweight, larger-than-life figure who made an impact. The Iranians respected his ability and his directness. I regularly accompanied him to meetings with the head of Iran's Atomic Energy Organization, Akbar Etemad. I thought Marshall had blown it one evening when Etemad gave a dinner in his honor, and Marshall, impressed by the decisiveness of his Iranian counterparts, said in his toast that he could see that there were clear advantages to government by dictatorship. There was a pause, and then everyone broke out laughing. His hosts knew that Marshall's heart was in the right place. The late and legendary American reporter Arno de Borgrave once told me that the Shah had admitted to him in 1973 that the aim of his nuclear program was to develop a weapons capability so he could help the West police the Gulf, following the UK's decision to withdraw from its military commitments east of Suez. Etemad records that, in response to his own direct question on the subject, the Shah told him that building a nuclear weapon would guarantee Iran's international isolation. The foreign governments, which were busy developing cooperative programs with Etemad and his colleagues, were glad to give his boss the benefit of the doubt. Indeed, we were more than happy to accept the Shah's argument that Iran's oil and gas reserves were too valuable a resource to be burned up unnecessarily producing electricity. At the time, no Western government seemed to fear that he was intending to develop nuclear weapons. Today, Iranian officials are adamant that they are not, and legally could not be, developing a nuclear weapons program. But I have sometimes wondered during the intervening years whether we were missing something, and whether the Ayatollahs, even more convinced of the need to take security seriously by the West's support for Saddam Hussein in the Iran-Iraq War, 1980 to 1988, didn't take a conscious decision to continue a weapons option first envisaged by the man they overthrew. Since the early part of the 16th century, when the Safavid dynasty made it the country's official religion, Iran has adhered to the Shia branch of Islam, while most of the Arab world and the rest of South Asia has been Sunni. The Shia-Sunni schism goes back to the 7th century, when there was disagreement over the succession to the Prophet Muhammad after the death of his son-in-law Ali. Over the centuries, the Sunnis have regarded the Shia as inferior heretics. Successive Sunni Ottoman sultans and Shia Persian kings were, nevertheless, generally successful in keeping their religious differences under control. The seizure of power in Iran in January to February 1979 by the Shia Ayatollah Khomeini, just a short distance across the Persian Gulf from the Sunni Wahhabists of Saudi Arabia, changed all that. In fact, 1979 was a turning point in the history of the Middle East. In Iran, the revolution set the country on a radical, intolerant, brutal path, which threatened secularists and moderate Muslims, Sunni and Shia alike, throughout the region, as well as Western democracies and the State of Israel. A few months later, Sunni Saudi Arabia lurched towards a fundamentalism of its own, following the seizure of the Grand Mosque of Mecca by Sunni fanatics during the annual Hajj pilgrimage. Seeing it as a warning that change was coming too fast, the monarchy reacted by turning Saudi society back towards a more literal...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.